This video is brought to you by Vendor Finance. If you're looking for car finance and want the best available motor finance rates, check out vendorfinance.ie and apply online today. Vendor Finance is 100% Irish owned. See the comments section for more details.
Are you in the market for a fun size SUV? Do you want to sit slightly higher up in traffic but not quite take up so much space on the tarmac and also not quite pay a full fat SUV price? Well, good, because today we've brought two very good examples of cars that do just that. Here with me today, I've got the Ford Puma, a car that burst onto the scene here last year and has become a firm favourite on Irish roads very quickly. I see these everywhere and I can see why. It's a very cute car. But yes. Cute is not all it has going for it, which we'll get into shortly. But tell me, what is this angular contraption you've brought, Anthony?
This angular contraption, as you so mildly put it, is Opel's brand new Mokka. And prices start from just under €23,000. You can get it in petrol, diesel, or all electric. Now, most Opels today are based on Peugeot's platform, so this is very closely based on the Peugeot 208. And that injection of French flair has done it absolutely no harm at all, to my eyes anyway, because the previous generation Mokka was forgettable, shall we say. I can't even picture it. And this is a very different story. This is good looking, isn't it?
That is a funky car, yes. I must admit. I can't believe it's a Mokka.
I know, it's such a glow up. Like, if you looked at glow up in a dictionary, I think you'd see... Well, you'd probably see the fellow who played Neville Longbottom in Harry Potter.
Oh yeah, he's buff now.
He is so buff now, wow. But this would be a close second. It'd be, you know, in the footnotes of the dictionary. It's a looker.
Definitely. So they're two very good looking cars, I think, but in very different ways. As I said, yes. I think mine is more cute, even though this is the ST Line X, which is one of the kind of fancier specs. So you've got nice 18-inch alloy wheels and an ST Line body kit. So it is quite sporty too. Price-wise for this one, in and around the same ballpark, you can get an entry-level Puma from about 25. This ST-Line X starts at about 28. Now, there's a fair few optional extras thrown onto this one. Most of them quite nice, I have to say, but that does make the price climb towards a shade under €32,000. So it's a sliding scale, but it can slide right up there.
Yes, this is pretty similarly spec'd, and it is the SRI, so sporty model, and in around €32,000. And if you look at any of the press stuff, this is the design that Opel have used for all the funky cool people who do trendy things like basketball, skateboarding, tattoos, big headphones, and they look like fishermen but have never been fishing in their lives.
I definitely do get those vibes off that. Yeah. It's a little hipster, shall we say?
Yeah, maybe, yeah.
So you like it?
Oh. Yeah, I do.
Right, so looks are always going to be subjective.
Yes.
You'll either like one or the other. It's all good. But what you can't argue with is space and practicality. So shall we see how they measure up space-wise?
Yes. Boots?
Yes.
Let's go.
So the Puma's boot measures in at a very impressive for the size, I think, 456 litres.
Very.
But the real party trick back here is that that's not all immediately visible. Because you've got this thing called a mega box underneath.
Wow.
So when you lift up this false floor, which will stay up thanks to these handy little contraptions here, you've got an extra 80 litre storage compartment with a little drainage plug underneath.
Magic.
So like the possibilities are endless there. You could, like, I suppose mainly if you've got wet gear on, you can just throw it into the boot. Without worrying, you know, mucky boots, that kind of thing.
Smell.
Anything that smells.
You could wash stuff in it too.
You could wash your car. Yeah. I mean, you could use it as a foot spa.
You could wash your baby.
You could wash your baby in it. Yeah. Who hasn't had a sink bath in
exactly.
Ireland?
The 90s.
So, like, the possibilities are endless, but it's a really simple but cool little feature, and I love stuff like that that's, like, unique.
It does sound like a takeaway order, though. Mega box. 2 mega box, please.
Extra fried chicken.
Yeah, exactly.
Other than that, we've got a couple of shopping bag hooks here. You can drop the back seats from back here because it's quite short, but they don't really fold flat. And also, we've got an electric tailgate. I have to say, I find this a little bit unnecessary.
Bit overkill.
Just given the size of the car, I feel like it'd be easier. I keep going to just shut it myself, and I feel like it'd be quicker because if you do this, you're kind of like...
Doo-doo-doo.
I could have driven off by now.
You could have, yeah. Do you want to see my boot?
Yes.
So, Mokka boot, would you do me the honour of opening it, please?
Sure.
Easy, isn't it? It's usually. Yeah. You're getting.
Feels like it should be.
You're getting warmer.
Not in the.
You know, they sometimes they hide them in the lights.
Ah.
I'll admit, took me a while to figure that one out as well. Under the, or just over the number plate. Weird.
So when you figure it out.
When you lift it up, you reveal 350 litres. You can drop the seats down and get about 1,000 litres. There's two hooks either side. But we are not furnished with your mega box, unfortunately.
What mega box?
No, it's just a space, or not even a spare tyre, just...
I didn't even know the mega box existed until I had the Puma, but now yeah. I can't live without one.
Can't live without one. And this closes the old-fashioned way, if you could do that as well.
Effort.
There you go. Simple.
So I think it's fair to say that the Puma probably wins the boot space.
Yes, you've taken it thanks to your mega box and just generally more space.
So how did you find it sitting in the back of the Puma behind my driving position?
Yeah, so for reference, I'm 183 centimetres and in the back I was very comfortable behind your driving position. Plenty of legroom. Headroom was tight, but manageable day to day, shall we say.
Sitting in the back of the Mokka behind your driving position, I had plenty of legroom and headroom did feel a little bit better.
Yeah, you are 167
centimetres.
Ah, centimetres is great, aren't they?
But all in all, I don't think there's a huge amount in it.
No, they're very similar. Like, you're talking tiny margins. They're very similar.
So what's your first impressions of sitting into the cabin of the Puma ST Line X?
Well, the touch points are perfect for the driver. I'd have no real complaints. Love the steering wheel. The padding is perfect. It looks well. Really wouldn't have complaints about that. Seats are really nice. They're the perfect amount of bolster and squidginess.
They're awesome.
And they look really well too. Six-speed manual feels good. Old school handbrake as well. There's not much complaints, really.
I agree. I really like it from a driver's point of view. Like you said, all the driving touch points are there. Also, shout out to the manual aircon controls. These are excellent. This is done. This, take note, other manufacturers, because this is done perfectly.
Yeah.
I mean, it's so straightforward. You've got dials to turn your heat up and down, your air intake up and down, and also there's even, they've even gone to the trouble of putting pictures on which
where it
part
goes.
Of your body you'd like the air to flow.
Your mom would be so happy.
My
mom
would be
straightforward.
She wouldn't have to be fiddling with any of those touch screens.
Just confusing the life out of her.
On that note, this touch screen.
Yes.
Is really good. This is the Ford Sync 3 system. Now it's pretty straightforward.
Yeah.
As in, it's the graphics aren't going to blow your mind, but the functionality is really good. It's very simple, works first time, every time, and I've actually really grown accustomed to it. I like the simplicity.
Yeah, it's very blue.
It is. Blue is calm. There's actually a mode that you can select on it called calm mode. So say when you're trying to take some time out from your very important job as a motor and journalist,
oh, yeah,
and you
want to
forget about the fuel economy for a minute, it just gives you this nice calm blue screen. It doesn't have everything. You can project your sat nav onto it, for example.
I can. We'll get on to that.
But overall, I like it. Downsides? The quality is more than patchy in some
parts. You do need to look for it.
You do. That's the thing. The touch points are good, but if you go looking for it, there is a bit of give in some of the plastics, which doesn't
feel
great.
Door bins and...
Yeah, but as you said, you would have to look for it.
Yes, and this is ST Line...
ST Line X. So the trim levels on the Ford go, you've got your entry level titanium, ST Line mild sport effect, ST Line X more sport effect, ST Line Vignale fancy posh effect.
ST, it means nothing anymore.
But then you've got your actual ST.
Okay, so ST really does mean nothing anymore. It's just thrown in there now.
Well.
Do you like the carbon fibre?
I do like that. I do like that. And it's one of the reasons why I think the ST Line really lifts this interior.
Yeah. Splashes of red, too.
Of course, because sports.
But do you know what? We'll get on to splashes of red in my one. Do you want to have a look at the Mokka?
Yes, please.
What do you think?
Well, this cabin is fabulous.
It's good, isn't it?
There's, like, no arguing there. It's got the same kind of nice, simple effect of the Puma. You've got your manual aircon controls. Yep. So streamlined.
Perfect.
And these pops of colour, it's like it's a more modern version of what's in the Puma.
Yeah, a bit more exaggerated red and carbon fibre too.
Really driver focused. I love this wraparound effect.
Yeah, the wraparound screen is nice where the kind of the infotainment runs into the digital dash as well, which is okay.
Right.
It's a bit tricky to use and the Ford is definitely more simple, but it probably does look a bit better.
It does look well.
And the digital cockpit, to be fair, is really good. And you do have like extra options like putting your sat-nav on it.
Yeah, I mean, the graphics are really good. There's a lot more colour and stuff going on there. Great steering wheel.
Yeah.
Similar to the Puma, nice size, bit of chunk. You don't have the kind of perforated leather.
No padding as well.
No, it's a good effort.
It's good effort, yeah. It's nice and clean, good slick lines. I mean, what would you call it? Flash and modern, maybe, in comparison?
Yeah, it is definitely... It's awesome.
It's awesome.
It's got the wow factor. I'd probably, for looks alone, I'd have to give it to the Mokka on this one.
Yeah, this is the SRI, as we alluded to earlier. So it's about 27 starting, and I think 30-something for this one. So, will we drive them?
Yes, we should. So this is the 1 litre EcoBoost petrol. It's available in both automatic and 6-speed manual, like this one here. And there's also a 1.5 litre diesel. Now, it is a mild hybrid.
Really?
This is a tricky one to get into. It's a mild hybrid. I'm not going to say it's misleading, but it is can be a little bit confusing for the customer, I think, because there's a hybrid badge on the back of it, which my dad spotted. Loves this car, by the way, so it's definitely not just a female thing. He was like, "What's that? It's gorgeous. Is it a hybrid?" And I said, "Well, buckle up."
Buckle up, boyo. We have a story for you now.
So, just to be clear, it's not a hybrid in the plug-in sense of the word. You don't plug it in. But it's not even really a hybrid in the Toyota sense of the word. I know we have to stop saying that.
Cool.
But what I mean is the battery doesn't ever really power the engine. But it does harness some power back from the engine and regenerative braking to power some ancillary bits and bobs. And it does, in fairness, make stop-start a little smoother. So it's nice in that respect. But in terms of a hybrid, it's not going to have any major effects on the fuel economy. Now, to be fair, I have been averaging 6.9 litres per 100 kilometres, which for a 1 litre petrol engine, which has done a lot of time on the motorway this week, isn't bad.
No, that's pretty decent. And that's about the same as the Mokka before we even drive it. So
interesting.
Get that out of the way.
Interesting. Yeah. So yeah, that's the hybrid situation. This 1 litre EcoBoost engine, 125 PS, lovely engine. I think I said it before, I just really love it. It's a lovely, peachy, fizzy little thing. Suits the Puma so well. Plenty of power available when you need it. Nice and refined on the motorway. Not in any ways, like, noisy or complainy.
No windy noises.
No, it's pretty good. Aerodynamic. It's good in that respect.
Yeah.
But for me, the Puma, it's really all about the handling. It just handles so well. It's got that unmistakable Ford feel, which to me is like super grip, super planted around corners, you know, a spot on suspension setup. And despite this being like a mini SUV thing, it handles nothing like an SUV to me. Like it could be a Fiesta, you know, it's just...
Yeah, no, I drove this a year ago. And for me as well, it's probably the best in class of those small crossovers. And whatever they do in Ford, whatever lads or ladies are running the chassis department, they're on the ball.
Keep it up, guys.
Oh, so good, so good. Best in class.
Comfort-wise, it's really good as well. Now, I do have to say that this cabin, to me, feels a little bit, I want to say, cosseted, a little bit cosy. Like, you're in it.
Wedged
you're
in it.
You're in it, like, a bit.
Yeah.
Did you find that you're obviously taller than me?
Slightly. You do feel, yeah, more in it, not on it, is what maybe the Mokka has that sense about. More crossover.
Yeah, like
feel.
A small bit more space, yeah. And maybe a little bit of extra height.
Slightly.
You're not raised hugely off the ground either.
No, it doesn't feel like that anyway. I don't know.
Slightly,
the specifics,
but not over the top. So we're both in agreement then that this is the best in class.
Yes.
So should we go and drive the Mokka then?
Yes.
And get a big
not
surprise
the best
there.
In class. So the Mokka. Well, options are pretty similar to the Puma as well when it comes to engines. So you have a 1.2 petrol with either 100 brake horsepower, 130 brake horsepower, and a 1.5 diesel with 110 brake horsepower, I do believe. Correct me if I'm wrong, because I can't remember. But
what
anyway.
The fancy new EV.
Oh yeah, I did brush over that, didn't I? Maybe we'll get back to that, because we actually have that booked in, and we have a nice little twin test with that in the future, the E-Mokka.
Stay tuned.
Yeah, stay tuned. Tuned forever, guys. And then you can get a 6-speed manual or an 8-speed automatic. And today, we have the 1.2, 130 brake horsepower, and the 8-speed automatic. And I can see why they've put this one on the press fleet, because it's an absolute little peach and it's a great combination. I really wouldn't have any complaints. It's an impressive little engine, and particularly that 130 brake horsepower, it feels like more. It's really got this like get up and go to it, and quite a sporty drive.
I really like this engine as well, I have to say, and I think the two are really well matched. I think there's very little in it.
Very little, like From my memory, I'd probably just go for this slightly, but you're talking tiny margins again.
Yeah, well, for me, it's the kind of combination of the handling with the Puma that makes it the complete package.
Yeah. Do we need to get into handling?
Sure,
why not? Yeah, it's not its strong point on the Mokka, and it certainly doesn't match the Puma just for engagement and that sort of planted fun feeling of most Fords.
Can I say something, actually?
No.
I don't like the interior as much as a passenger as I did as a driver, because it's really driver focused, and now that I'm sitting in the passenger seat, I feel really excluded. Like, you'd slap my hand away if I went to try and...
Yeah, I would. I would. You're not allowed. Really?
Yeah. No, I feel like I'm, like, I'm totally shut out here.
You don't matter. Only the driver matters in this, does it? All right, fair enough, fair enough. Anyway, back to this stuff, the driving. It's pretty comfortable. It's good on the motorway, good refinement. Wind noise is a bit higher than I would like. And the only issue I have with some of the refinement and comfort and suspension and that is over, like, larger ramps in town, it could do with softening off a bit. It is a bit harsh at times.
Yeah, I can feel that.
Like, it's not bad, but it's there. I know about it. And if I was... Another thing to give out about was the brakes. They're just slightly snatchy. Without being... Not much feel off them, shall we say. Now, one nice little treat, and I think it's kind of a party trick here, is actually sport mode feels like it does something.
Oh, yeah?
Even if it's totally superficial, it's just... It gives it a bit more kick, and it's kind of louder as well.
Where is it? Can I see?
It's down here, yeah. Pop it. Now, hold on to something once you put it down. Okay. We're in sport now. Now, hold on.
Hold on, sorry. Oh, it goes on.
No, you go back to normal.
Oh, okay, okay.
Sport.
Okay, okay. Right, ready?
Are we in sport?
Am I ready?
I don't think we're in sport. No, we're in sport.
Okay.
We're in sport. Right, ready. Hold on.
Oh, wow.
See how loud it is? Yeah, and it actually sounds pretty damn good.
I like a bit of drama.
Yeah.
I also have to give back something to the cabin here. I give it and I take it away.
Go on.
Even though it's not focused towards me, you do have a few nice extra bits and bobs here that I didn't get in the Puma for a similar price range.
Yes.
Including a reversing camera.
Yeah.
I've been lost without mine this
really?
Week. Really? I don't. My old-fashioned eyes and wing mirror.
Imagine your intuition.
It is crazy. It's crazy how quickly you get used to a creature comfort like
that. Doesn't it?
But I missed your reversing camera. You've got heated seats. That's nice.
Yeah, heated fabric seats, which is rare.
Yeah, that is
rare.
Rather
than leather.
That's nice, because sometimes the leather and heated combination can be a bit hot.
Also, that gearbox is very good. All 8 speeds of it. And the best compliment I can pay it is I barely notice it's there.
So, conclusion time.
Yay! These are very closely matched.
They are.
This is tricky.
It's a lot closer than I thought it was going to be.
Yeah, it is.
It was a really good twin test.
It was. We're so
close. Pat on the back to us. I think an awful lot of it is going to come down to the way they look, and because they're so different, that's the tricky one.
Yeah. They have a different approach to... Both very good looking, but a very different approach to that.
Yes. Mine is cute. Yours is like more... It's definitely a head turner.
Yeah, it's kind of stormtrooper.
I appreciate the vibes. But I think I'd prefer to live with this one.
You're more cute orientated, are you?
In this instance, maybe.
Yeah, I think I prefer the looks of the Mokka. Just that aggressive stance and just this look. It's doing it for me. But this drives better. That boot is bigger. The interior is not as nice. So...
Yeah, I'm totally with you there. Better drive, bigger boot. But the tech in yours slightly pips it for me.
Yeah.
And the interior is...
It's visually better.
Visually better.
Yeah, so they're very close. And it depends on what lights your boat. Close your candle?
That old saying.
Yeah, that one. We leave it there.
Puma for me?
Yeah, Mokka, I think Mokka for me, just.
It'd be great to get a bad car, wouldn't it?
Yeah, someday. No one does bad cars anymore.
Well, you've had a few.
I've had a few bad cars, but we won't get into that. We're here all day.
Two more very good cars on the way next week. So if you'd like to check that out, please do make sure to subscribe. Give us a like and a share if you enjoyed this video. And join us back here next week for more deadly rivalry.
Yeah.